In this video, I will discuss the GK inverter BMS dry contact problem. The issue being that sometimes on some boards, one or both relays mysteriously will not toggle even though the conditions to switch them have been reached. The first person to correctly identify the root cause is, as far as I know, Mario Hogenboom. I will provide a link to his video in the comments, but it is in Dutch. I will repeat his conclusions for the root cause and his fix and then propose a different fix that I opted for on my board. So let's dive into the root cause of the problem. When we look at the PCB, we can derive the following schematic. There is a signal coming from a shift register going towards an optocoupler, which on the output side of the optocoupler allows for a current to flow through the relay so that it can toggle. To make it a bit more concrete, I have mapped the schematic to the components of the PCB. And if you are a bit lost where exactly we are on the PCB, here is a map and a sped up disassembly video to help you get your bearings. Now, an optocoupler is something called a CTR, or current transfer ratio, in its specification, which tells you how many amps the output can carry for a given amount of amps at the input. Since there is a conforma coating on the PCBs to help them protect against condensation shorts, it takes a bit of effort to clean up the chips to see their markings. But if you do, then you will find that the optocouplers used are of the type EL357NC. These have a CTR between 200 and 400%, depending on the actual current, temperature, etc. Now, if you measure the voltage over the resistor in series with the input signal of the optocoupler, you get about 2 volt when the relay is activated. Since we're talking about a 500 ohm resistor, we know that the current going through the optocoupler is 2 volt divided by 500, so 4 milliamps. Suppose the CTR is at the lower bound of 200%, then that means it can carry about 8 milliamps at the output. And that is just not enough for the relay. If you calculate the resulting voltage over the relay with the specified call resistance, you get 7.68 volt. The rest of the voltage is eaten by the optocoupler. The datasheet of the relay states that the pickup voltage, which is the point at which the relay toggles, is 9 volt. So the 7.68 volt is too low to trigger the relay. In Mario's case, he measured about 9 volt on his non-working relay, so just on the edge of working, not working. In some cases it will work, in others it won't. There are 3 things we can change to fix this. 1. We can send more input current towards the optocoupler. 2. We can select an optocoupler with a higher CTR. Or 3. We can select a relay with a lower pickup voltage. Mario fixed his board with the first option, by replacing the input series resistor with a lower one, a 220 ohm, so that the current going towards the optocoupler more than doubles. This does not necessarily mean that the output current will double as well, as the CTR curve is not linear, but it should be enough to make sure there is enough current passing through the relay to toggle it. Note that the device driving the optocoupler needs to be able to source the higher currents too, and the datasheet of the level shifter used here to drive those lines is sending me a bit mixed signals regarding this. Is the 6 mA maybe per output and the 35 mA the combined total for all outputs? Because in that case the 6 mA might be a problem for Mario's fix. Since I like to make life difficult, and I don't like the extra wasted current at the inputs, I went for option number 2 and replaced my optocouplers. Now, there are a number of different types of optocouplers. The ones on the board are phototransistor ones. You can get those with a CTR a bit higher than what we have on the board now, but not a lot more. But there is another type called photo-Darlington transistors, where a second transistor is added inside the optocoupler, which acts as an amplifier. So you have CTRs which are much higher. They have disadvantages, like that they are a bit slower and even less linear, but these properties are not that important for this application. Sadly, the type I ordered may not have been the most suitable one dimension-wise. I was mainly focusing on picking something with the correct width, CTR and dark current properties, and ended up going for the ISP815XSM. But I was not paying enough attention to the length, which was something with 7 mm for both of them, so how much can they differ, right? Well, it turns out quite a lot. The replacement looks gigantic compared to the original. Luckily, it is quite easy to bend the legs a bit inwards so it matches the pads on the PCB of the original to solder them on, but it might be interesting to look into some other candidates. If you do, pay attention to the minimum CTR ratio, though with the Darlington one this should not be an issue, and the dark current. The latter is the current going through it when there is no current at the input, so that is a pure loss you want to limit. Now, for how to replace them, it is probably possible to do it with a soldering iron, but since the component has 4 pins, it will be very tricky. Maybe soldering tweezers wide enough to cover 2 pins with each leg, or two soldering irons with flat heads used as tweezers. In any case, I used my hot air workstation, which really makes life easier. Before starting, we first need to figure out which pins are what, so we can orient the replacement correctly. Normally pin 1 on ICs is indicated with a small dot next to it on the casing. But due to the coating, which I had not yet removed at this point, this was impossible to see. However, we know that pins 2 and 3 on the schematic of both optocouplers are paired together. I have rotated the schematic to match the two possible configurations on the board. So with a quick continuity test, it is possible to determine the orientation. So with this result, we know that it is the first option. And with the information in the datasheet from the replacement, we know where the dot on the casing should end up. I did not record this step as I don't have a microscope at the moment, and using the micro lens of my camera close to hot air is a really bad idea. I also need my two hands for the process. But to simulate the steps, heat up the area around the original component till the solder becomes liquid, lift it up with some tweezers, and put the replacement component in its place. For soldering SMD components, normally you use solder paste, and they get sucked into the right spot when you heat it up. But in this case, I just used regular solder wire, and wetted the pins of the component a bit before placing them. Given the size of the component and the mismatch between solder pads and pins, positioning was a bit delicate, but it turned out fine in the end. It is best to add some protection to divert hot air away from the connector and the relay. I started without it and melted the plastic a bit. A small piece of wood prevented further damage, and luckily functionality remained intact, so I did not need to replace my connector as well. For good measure, I reapplied some Conforma coating to the contacts. Now on to testing. First a remark about software versions. I started out with version 15.24 in my board. I was under the impression that I did not hear the second relay click when I tried triggering it. Only the first one worked. After upgrading to 15.38, I could hear both of them clicking. But I am not 100% sure of my initial observation, so take it with a grain of salt. Version 15.38 came with, I think, a new feature that apparently if the battery sense wires are not connected, the board will turn itself off after a few minutes, even if you connect it to it with Bluetooth or RS-485. I could not find a way to disable this automatic turn-off. During normal operation that behavior would of course be okay, but not when you have an active connection to it to maybe troubleshoot a problem. It made testing the board on my bench a real race against time. But I did not want to spend time making a resistor ladder and hooking it up to the battery sense wires. For testing, I hooked up wires to measure the voltage over the relay to see if it was safely above the pickup voltage, and then connected those wires to two voltage meters. I switched between no configured trigger and a low temperature trigger with a high enough temperature threshold setting to toggle the relay between off and on. As you can see, I get voltages of 10.2 volts, so that will always trigger the relay as the maximum pickup voltage was specified to be 9 volts. It was still lower than I expected though, as I was under the impression the supply voltage was 12 volts. But when I measured the supply voltage, it is only 11.08 volts. I am not sure why that is the case, but it explains the lower than expected coil voltage. I was also interested to measure the extra consumption of the BMS when the relay is activated. As I am simulating my system which uses 8 batteries in series, my power supply is set to 26 volt. The right meter now measures the total current consumption of the BMS. It goes from 36 milliamps to 45 milliamps when activating a single relay. So that's a bit less than 250 milliwatt per active relay.